Channel 56 News and Public Affairs, in cooperation with the Cambridge Forum, presents Cambridge USA, a look at Cambridge, yesterday, today, and in the future.
The Cambridge community is well known for its grassroots efforts to curb the arms race, but perhaps less well known are the people here in our city who are also bringing a different kind of expertise to this issue. At Harvard and MIT, some of the foremost strategic planners in the country are using their knowledge of weapon systems towards the same goal, the prevention of nuclear war. I'm Jim Vetter of the Cambridge Forum, which produces this program, and today on Cambridge USA, I'm going to be talking with four nuclear planners. With me in this first half of the program is Carl Kaysen, Director of the Program on Science, Technology, and Society at Massachusetts Institute of Technology. Welcome to the program.
How are you, Jim?
It's good to have you here. Also with us is Gerald Zacharias. Professor Zacharias is a Professor Emeritus of Physics at MIT. Both of the professors have been involved for quite some time in the issue of strategic planning. Welcome to the program.
Indeed.
Professor Kaysen, if you can start off by telling me a little bit about how you originally got involved in nuclear planning.
Well, as President Kennedy, for whom I worked for a while, said about another matter, it was just an accident. During the Second World War, I was in an Air Force intelligence, and I got involved in a group that was trying to find a rationale for picking bombing targets. Recommending specific targets and evaluating the effects of our air raids when we hit them, which wasn't always. And that aroused an interest which continued, and off and on during the period after the war, I acted as a consultant to the RAND Corporation, the Defense Department, and so on. I went down to Washington to work for Mack Bundy, who was the President's Assistant for National Security Affairs. I went down as a senior staff member on the NSC and then became his deputy. During that period, I once again got involved in some of the issues that I'd first looked at almost 20 years before in a rather different form.
You know, Professor Zacharias, you're a physics professor.
Yes.
So you were involved, I would guess, in the nuts and bolts end of this issue, in the real, the physics of it.
Nuts and bolts don't have any meaning without what you're going to do with them.
Okay.
In other words, if you include the entire planning, the answer is yes.
Okay. How did you get involved?
If you'd let me interpret your question to mean how did I get involved with being so worried about nuclear weapons? Because I'm not afraid that there's going to be a war, except by some kind of miscalculation. In other words, nobody, neither the Soviet, no nation, unless it's absolutely out of its mind, is going to initiate any kind of nuclear war. So what in describing, let me say, how I got into it, what bothers me more than that is what kept me away for the last 38 years from trying to plan with all of my energy and all of my life what to do about nuclear weaponry. So let me haul back. In a couple of years before Pearl Harbor, year and a half, France had been taken over by Hitler's Wehrmacht. It wasn't destroyed, it was just taken in what would now one would think as a very gentle way. But it was taken nonetheless, and Britain was being beat up. And I was a physicist, experimental physicist, and many of us wondered what in the world we could do with our expertise to help the American military or the military of the our side to do better. And what we needed was leadership, and this came from Cambridge. Van Bush of MIT and Jim Conant of Harvard and Carl Compton of MIT, and we set up a big electronics lab to make microwave radar. And it grew and grew, and we helped defend the shipping lanes from the German submarines.
And from there you went to Los Alamos?
And there went to Los Alamos to be head of the engineering division. And the problem that they put into my plate when I got there was, how do you keep these things from blowing up if the B-29 that totes them happens to crash? How do you keep it from going nuclear explosive? And incidentally, how do you fix it so the American military can operate them instead of having to have scientists, many of whom are in this town still, sending them along with those bombs? But the issue, what bothers me, is why, because we knew what would happen, we knew how it would grow, we knew how the explosive power would grow, we knew the Russians would be able to make these things, we knew exactly how some of us, not the higher-ups, but some of us who were in charge of materials, knew how long it would take the Russians to make them. I missed by 1 year in my guess. I guessed 5 years, and the Russians took 4.
What was the reaction in nuclear planning circles when the bombs were dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki?
Zach, you can speak to that.
It was hangdog. I mean, if you look at the dropping of bombs on Hiroshima and Nagasaki, it saved lives. It saved probably 1 million American soldiers and sailors and Air Force, and it saved one hell of a lot of Japanese. I think one other thing why we didn't feel guilty, we knew perfectly well there wasn't any other way, to expose this dreadful business to the public of the world. And we knew even before they were dropped that that would have to be done. You couldn't make a demonstration. One of the young physicists said, in answer to the question, what would happen if you had a demonstration without actually destroying people? What would you do for the people you'd brought in to observe? You'd have to shoot them. Because all they would see is that the thing didn't work. And that you couldn't put up with.
Well,
this is in the middle of a war.
I wonder about that, but maybe this isn't the point to talk about it. Zach, I just read something you may have read at the time, a reissue of a book by a man called David Bradley, No Place to Hide. Bradley was a doc who went along on the bikini tests, and he describes the impact of the radioactivity, which nobody had expected. Both what happened, the persistence, the almost incredulity of the Navy people in charge of those ships that were being used as demonstration targets, at the fact that when all the standard things were done, people in protective gear and working a little bit at a time not to get overexposed, scrubbing these ships down in the standard ways, and then observing that nothing had happened, that the ships were just as dangerous, and, something that's no surprise to you, but was a great surprise to the Navy people at the time. Have you looked at that thing?
I haven't looked at it, but I can assure you the man must be right, because in 1950, after the Soviet Union had blown what we call Joe 1, their first atom bomb. We had to decide what were we going to do. I picked on the job, or was asked, to study undersea warfare.
Right.
And to study how do you detect submarines. And one of the recommendations we found we had to make is that the American military was thoroughly ignorant of the effects. This is in 1950.
Yes. So after the bomb was dropped, you're saying that the military just had no sense.
5 years after.
Really, Professor Kaysen, when you're involved in the end of how the bombing could happen, now you've since that time come to the belief, as I understand, that it's simply not feasible to make those kind of plans. Why do you think that?
Well, I mean, you can make the plans, but it's what I believe is that it's not feasible to act as if you can find a sensible way to use nuclear weapons.
Why? What changed your thinking?
It's like standing behind a bazooka. A bazooka fires forward, but it also fires back.
Well, let me answer that question a little indirectly. When I was worrying about bombing in the Second World War, we had got up an elaborate theory. We had all kinds of interesting ideas. And they were probably good ideas, except we didn't have the force to do anything that we proposed to do. For most of the period that we were bombing, we couldn't see, in the sense that our radar wasn't good enough to discern very much through the clouds. The weather's always bad in Northern Europe from about the middle of October to the middle of April. We couldn't navigate all that well. We couldn't deal with the anti-aircraft opposition all that well. So that our capacity to hit the kind of targets we were trying to hit with the force that we wanted to hit them, we really had that capacity only for about less than the last year of the war. And for most of the time that the RAF and the USF were doing it, we weren't accomplishing very much. We were burning down a lot of houses, killing quite a few people, but not a great number by modern standards, but not really having much impact. What we've done now is overleap the point where we could do anything rational with the weapons. The amount of force at our command is so great, it's hard to contain it.
You were mentioning also, if you can very briefly, the idea that the whole system of a nuclear attack would be so complicated that it simply couldn't be carried out.
Well, the idea of a contained, planned, phased attack in a situation in which you were under fire seems to me a fairly absurd idea.
Why so?
Let me just defer answering that question to say that one of the notions, scenarios, that had a lot of play during the election campaign, last election campaign in 1980, was the idea put forward by the Committee on the Present Danger and other people, that the Soviets could attack all our land-based missiles and destroy a very high fraction of them, and then present us with an alternative which we couldn't accept either horn of. You no longer have any effective striking power with precise aim. If you use what's left of your forces to blow up our cities, we'll blow up your cities. Well, the two elements of that seemed to me incredible then and seem to be incredible today, are one, that you could, if you were the Soviets, perform that attack with high enough confidence of success to gamble the fate of your whole society on its being successfully carried out.
And your second point?
In the you know, something, a very large-scale technical activity that had never been tried on anything like that scale, anything that way.
And you certainly
And the second point, of course, is the notion of predicting what the other fellows were going to do. They were going to wait for this to happen. They were going to wait to receive the messages saying, now that we've blown up all your land-based missiles, what are you going to do next? Considering that both sides have big signal systems that tell them when missiles are coming in and so on.
Professor Kaysen, I'm afraid we're out of time for this portion of the program. I'd like to thank both you and Professor Zacharias for coming on to talk with us.
Thank you.
We're going to be taking a little break right now, but when we come back, I'll be talking with two more nuclear planners, Albert Carnesale of Harvard and George Rathjens of MIT. Stay with us. We're back here on Cambridge, USA, talking with four nuclear planners. With me now is Albert Carnesale, professor of public policy at Harvard University. Welcome to the program.
Good to be here.
Also with us is George Rathjens, professor of political science at MIT.
Hello.
Professor Rathjens, can you give me a little bit of background? How did you get involved with strategic planning?
Well, in the immediate aftermath of the Korean War, in fact, during the Korean War, I guess I became persuaded that we were in for a long period of confrontation, or at least difficulties with the Soviet Union, a period in which weapons decisions would be important, and I decided to work on them. I did that first in the Defense Department, and then when the following Sputnik, in the White House, they really established an important office for dealing with these issues, and the President's science advisor, I went there particularly to deal with strategic weapons, working for George Kistiakowsky when he was Eisenhower's science advisor. That was really the beginning, and I've been involved ever since.
Now, Professor Carnesale, you've been particularly involved, I know, in the negotiations end of all this. Could you tell me a little bit about that?
Yeah, I'd like to attribute my involvement to brilliant planning, but there are too many people that know the truth. Actually, I went to Washington in the fall of 1969 on a sabbatical leave, the idea of mine being to work on non-proliferation issues for 1 year. I did that actually for 4 days and got involved in the SALT talks, the first strategic arms limitation talks that were to start the following month. And so my plans for a 1 year leave became actually 3 years of involvement in the first negotiations leading to the agreements in SALT I and a change in a career. I've sort of been working with that stuff ever since.
Now, for both of you, it must be a different perspective than the gentleman we talked with in the first half of the program. They came into this during World War II. It must be very different to approach nuclear weapons after World War II had already ended, after the bomb had been dropped.
Well, in part, yes, and in part, no. I think for those that were involved in the programs leading to the atomic bombs of World War II, there is a very different feeling, a very different kind of sense of responsibility that those people have, that we don't share quite that experience. But in terms of the world of nuclear weapons being very different than the world before it, I think we all have that in common. So I don't know that the experience of World War II sets us apart very much, so much as the involvement in the early programs leading to the atomic bomb.
But certainly the whole approach to nuclear weapons has changed considerably.
Well, it's changed over my period of involvement. When I first got involved in 1953, by and large, people still thought of these, at least the military did, and a large fraction of the technical community as well, as just ordinary weapons. We would use them pretty much as weapons had been used in World War II. We talked about strategic bombing campaigns, and the planning was not all that different. It was, well, I think, more during the late 50s and the 60s when there were changes in thinking about their utility. My own view is we're still going through that transition. There are people who still think these things can be used as useful political and military instruments. To me, they're living in a world that has disappeared. They're not caught up with reality yet.
But Professor Carnesale, as someone involved in negotiations, I take it that you feel it's certainly not something, nuclear weapons are not something we're going to eliminate overnight.
Well, I don't think you have to be involved in negotiations to come to that conclusion. No, I don't think that one can make nuclear weapons disappear. There are several kinds of escapism that people use with regard to nuclear weapons. One is the simple solution of let's just make them go away, disarmament. But if you stop and think of that a little while, then you have to realize that you also have to get rid of the knowledge of how to make them. And you have to get rid of them everywhere in all countries. And that's probably not a very realistic goal, certainly not a short-term one. But to pick up George's point, it is just as unrealistic to think of these weapons as being just like other weapons, and all you have to have is more of them, or more of them than any potential adversary, and that will solve the problem. That, too, would appear to be a simple solution. It's also unrealistic.
But with many of the people who are suggesting, particularly just individuals, grassroots people, who are suggesting completely abolishing nuclear weapons, isn't it often out of a feeling of not knowing what the options are, but knowing that something has to be done? It's the only thing that they know to suggest.
Well, they don't like the fact that these weapons are there. They feel impotent. They don't know what else to do. And so they want to wish them away. But people feel pretty much the same. A lot of people feel about the same way about cancer. It'd be nice if it didn't exist. And, and because of that, there are those who can sell them Laetril and other remedies that have no real utility, and there's no scientific foundation for believing that they will have utility. We find some of that same business here, too. People are deeply troubled by the existence of these weapons. They want them to go away, or they want somehow to be defended against them, and they look for any kind of solution, and never mind whether there is a real technical or political basis for it.
Now, another significant change that's happened during your involvement with nuclear weapons is just the access that ordinary people have to the information about the weapons.
Well, that has been an extraordinary change. When I got into this business, the information was very tightly held. Almost all of the documents that I read in those days had blank space wherever the number of weapons was discussed. And if you had to know that, somebody would come around and tell you that information on a very special clearance basis and that sort of thing. All that's changed. We now have a lot of the information in the public domain, and I would submit that almost all of the information that is really needed for the public to make judgments about particular weapon systems, or about the political utility of these weapons, or about the position that political candidates take, almost all of the relevant information is accessible to anybody who wants it.
What happens when people read all that information, look at the facts about nuclear weapons, and say, but what can I do?
Well, the main thing for them to keep in mind is what it is they're trying to do, what the objective is. One has to know something about nuclear weapons and something about the arsenals to be able to discuss the subject intelligently. But our objective should be to avoid nuclear war. That's the objective. The objective isn't to get fine-tuning of the arsenals or to change the characteristics a little bit or the numbers a little bit. Those things matter, but not very much. What matters is to make sure that these things aren't used.
And how do you do that?
Well, let me say, whenever people feel impotent and feel that they don't know very much about this subject, they should ask themselves, how much does a new president know when he comes into office about this subject? The answer is very little more than they do. And he has the major responsibility. How much does a new senator know when he comes into office? About almost nothing. So the fact is that their judgment, if they're willing to spend just a little bit of time learning the rudiments, is at least as good, of those of the officials who were charged with responsibility for making those decisions.
And once they have this information, what do they do with it?
Well, I think that the public has to play a role in this. They have to do it, I think most constructively through the political process. They have to make judgments about people they send to Congress and about the men whom they elect to be president. And I think they should do that to some degree, to a significant degree, on the position those people take with respect to these matters. I think that's particularly true of the presidency. I worry greatly about these weapons being used. I don't think the probability in any one year is very high, but probably the single most important attribute I would want of the man whom I'm going to vote for president is good judgment about handling this problem, because if it is mishandled and they are ever used, well, it would be a catastrophe of unimaginable proportions. So the electoral process is the way we have to deal with it.
Can the ordinary person really understand enough about this issue in order to make an informed judgment on the kind of choices that their legislators are making?
Absolutely. To answer that is clearly yes. I think all too many people decide that the threshold is too high, that they look at these articles in the newspaper and they're filled with abbreviations and technical terms and they decide it's hopeless, and beside that it's an unpleasant subject. It's not a subject they want to get into deeply. But the fact is there are several primers, good books around that people can read and learn enough of the basic matter to be able to understand those articles with no difficulty whatsoever, and to be able to form their own judgments about questions like what kinds of weapon systems we should buy or not buy, what kinds of policies for their use we should have or not have. I think an informed citizenry is capable of having views in this field as in most other areas of policy. It is no more technical, although the technicians would like you to think so.
You mentioned the idea that people are feeling hopeless. Why do you think we have real reason for hope?
Why do I think? Well, primarily there are several reasons. First of all, realize it has been 38 years since the end of World War II. These weapons and the enormous arsenals that exist do have some influence on the willingness of leaders to take risk. They realize that we could blow up the world. They notice that we have not even had conventional conflict with the Soviet Union. We have not had American and Soviet troops firing at each other with rifles or slingshots, because people know it could escalate. So there is that concern. I agree with the view of many that no sane leader would start a nuclear war because he thought he'd be better off with it than without it. So what we have to worry about is escalation from a conventional conflict, or miscalculation, or accident, or a third party through proliferation starting a nuclear war. It's those kinds of things, rather than the fancy technical calculations about how many of our land-based intercontinental ballistic missiles might be destroyed in some bolt from the blue, magnificently executed Soviet first strike. That's not where our emphasis should be. It is indeed a technical issue that is difficult to understand, but fortunately it's not an important one.
So if people take the time to read about these things, they'll be able to absorb it, they can have an impact in the political process, we have some reason for hope.
Well, I think so.
I'm afraid we're out of time right now, gentlemen. I'd like to thank both of you for being on the program. It's good to see that there are some people like you who are providing the sort of intellectual planning behind it that the rest of us can then take and use to make the decisions that you were discussing. I'd like to thank you both for being on the program.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And I'd like to thank you for watching. And we hope you join you again next week here on Cambridge USA. We'll be right back.